In the first video of this series, we saw how to do a one-port calibration of a network analyzer. Now I will explain how to calibrate for two ports and some final remarks. If you want to measure these parameters of a two-port network, the calibration procedure is a bit tedious but easy to understand. Again, you need to specify first the frequency range and set the averaging. You press the averaging key and switch the averaging to on. Then we press the calibration button again and choose calibrate menu. Now you must specify full two port, and a menu is shown displaying the labels for the three main parts of the calibration procedure. We start with the first item, reflection, which leads you to a process similar to the one-port calibration we explained before, where you must connect the same standards at each port. Once you finish the reflection measurements, you press reflection done, and with this you go back to the full two-port menu. Next, you select transmission and connect between port 1 and 2, and a standard consisting in a short section of a coaxial line. Then you can press do both forward and reverse. In the last part of the calibration, you do isolation measurements. These measurements need that you physically isolate ports 1 and 2, for instance by connecting matched loads to both ports. Then you press do both forward and reverse. If you are not interested in wide dynamic ranges or very low transmission coefficients, you can skip this step by choosing omit isolation. Nevertheless, you don't save much time by doing this. Only systematic errors can be corrected with the calibration. Other errors related to drifts and noise will remain. Drift errors might come from active device gain drifts, thermal expansion of cables, or frequency conversion instabilities of mixers. Random errors are completely unpredictable and may come from the noise of either the instrument or the device under test, as well as from the lack of repeatability of switches and connectors. You can save the calibration parameters to reduce the number of times you do a calibration. But a new calibration is especially important if you have replaced, cleaned or repaired cables or connectors, or you notice significant changes in the environmental conditions like humidity or temperature changes. You might want to enlarge the time at which your calibration remains valid by reserving for your instrument an open and well-ventilated place in a laboratory free of dust and with low temperature drifts. You should check linearity and maximum power at the instrument ports when measuring amplifiers or other devices with gain. You might need to reduce the power of the signals generated by the analyzer. Special procedures are needed when measuring long cables or other devices with long transit times. In this case, the signal frequency at the end of the device lags behind the network analyzer source frequency. When the frequency shift is significant in comparison to the instrument's intermediate frequency bandwidth, and this bandwidth is typically a few kilohertz, then the measured result will be in error by the roll-off of the IF filter. In this case, you might want to ensure that the sweep speed doesn't make any influence on your measurement. You can reduce the sweep speed by, for instance, increasing the sweep time or increasing the number of points, or you can also use a stepped sweep or set a dwell time. Our network analyzer, like many other instruments currently in operation all around the world, only works with mechanical calibration kits, but it is possible to find other network analyzers with electronic calibration kits. They will offer you faster calibrations, but not better accuracy. They are equivalent in accuracy, provided that you change the internal through by an external one. Otherwise, they even might not be as accurate as a mechanical kit. The electronic kits are particularly valuable when you need to do frequent two-port calibrations. When working with them, you should check the ratings of maximum input powers, which are sometimes quite low in the cheapest models, and the robustness to electrostatic discharges, which become important if you work regularly in dry environments or with electromechanical devices.